Hello, everybody, and welcome to Activate Your Village. This is the final session that we have in this year's learning series, and I'm super excited to do a little intro for you. So my name is Charlie. I am the Communications and Outreach Manager for Within Reach, and I will be introducing Kerra today and kicking off this last session. So for those of you that are new to us, Within Reach is a nonprofit organization with statewide reach. At Within Reach, we believe that all families deserve to be healthy. So we help families navigate the complex health and social service systems and connect them with the resources they need to be healthy and safe. And we work in two specific ways. Our direct service team works with people one-on-one to identify their needs and provide them with immediate support that is close to home, whether that is healthcare, nutrition, parenting support, or child development services, we're there to help. The second is that we work at the systems level by building partnerships and advocating to improve the whole system. We know that we achieve longer lasting impact when we work together to break down barriers that prevent families from living healthy lives. So we invite you to connect with us if you or the families you work with could benefit from our services, and we are going to drop our information in the chat. And like I said, this is the last session of this week's learning series, and I'm super excited to be introducing Kerra Bauer. Kerra is the founder of RAZE Early Learning and Development Center in Spokane, which is a nonprofit daycare seeking to eradicate the school-to-prison pipeline in Eastern Washington through early learning programming that highlights our shared experiences and is created through the lens of the Black American. Today, Kerra is going to focus on what to look for in a quality childcare center, what questions to ask potential care providers, how to show up for your community in a meaningful way, and the importance of building a village of support. So thank you, Kerra, for being here with us today. A quick housekeeping note, there will be an opportunity to have your questions answered throughout the presentation. As you can see at the bottom of your screen, there is a Q&A function. Feel free to drop questions as they come up for you. We will also have a Q&A session at the end of the presentation. And we are recording today's session. We recorded all of the sessions from this week, and we'll be posting those next week. We will also be sending a follow-up email with the resources that Kerra is going to be sharing. So keep an eye out for that as well. So without further ado, I am excited to pass it over to Kerra.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you so much for having me here this afternoon and being able to share and just the wonderful work that you are all doing. I am going to go ahead and share my screen at this time. And all right. Thank you for your patience with that. I'd like to start off this afternoon's presentation with a brief land acknowledgement. And it says, as members in this community and human beings navigating this world, it is important that we acknowledge that we are living in the environments where Indigenous tribes once thrived and have forever been displaced. We acknowledge that people from the continent of Africa were kidnapped, brutally treated, and sold into slavery on this land. This nation was built on the backs of the Indigenous people, Black people and their African descendants, and generations of their descendants. They are yet to receive reparations for their work, generational trauma, and continued violence and oppression. We acknowledge that we have benefited from non-dominant culture and communities, turning to the work that has been passed down from ancestors who have transitioned and who are still sharing their gifts today. Particularly queer Black women organizers who are showing us what community care looks like. We can honor them by doing the work of racial justice and equity through our personal work and our work to change systems. We hold space to acknowledge the specific violence of missing and murdered Indigenous women and people, the murder of Black people, Black transgender women, the violent treatment of asylum seekers and refugees from different countries, which often comes from the harm the US has caused that leaves people without homes and without family and community connections. Examples such as our relatives from Haiti, Afghanistan, South and Central America are the traumas that continue due to the racist history. We acknowledge the continuation of anti-Asian hate and violence. We acknowledge the daily violence and transgressions against Black, Indigenous, Latinx, Asian and Pacific Islander, people of color, queer and transgender people, and children of color. Thank you. As we get started today, I want to start off by just saying thank you for being here. Thank you for recognizing the importance of early childhood education and understanding that first and foremost, when we say that we are looking for quality education, we need to recognize that quality looks very different for many, many people. And so today we're talking about activating your village. At first, centering the family and the parent as the primary source for education, nurture, safety, and stability, and realizing that as a community of businesses, of educators, we are the ones that are to surround and to support the family and to really be the village. And so this presentation is all about how, as a parent and as a family, you can activate your village. Tell you a little bit about myself. My name is Kerra Bauer. Again, I am the founder of RAZE Development Inc., which is a nonprofit here in Spokane, Washington, that focuses on dismantling the preschool to prison pipeline as it pertains to education and making sure that our children have what they need. So when we talk about the benefits of quality preschool, first and foremost, we need to understand that we are talking about one for the child, from the child's perspective, what is the benefit of quality preschool? First and foremost, we want to make sure that there is kindergarten readiness and that we are establishing a foundation for academic excellence. We want to make sure that our students are meeting the guidelines, and every school district has a various set of guidelines that they adhere to determine whether or not a child is kindergarten ready. And as a parent, you really need to know what those guidelines are. One of the very first resources that you'll find in the resource tool that we've provided today is the Kindergarten Readiness Guidelines for Spokane School District 81. And that's really going through line by line and understanding what it is that they're looking for. Whether it's we need to know the basic shapes, or we need to be able to recognize 10 letters, whatever that might be, we want to make sure that the preschool program or the childcare program that we're putting our student into provides that and knows what those resources or what those guidelines are. We also want to make sure that our children are socially and emotionally ready. And so does the center that you're looking at have social and emotional development guidelines? Do they have goals that they're reaching for? And is there a good balance of the academic and the social emotional awareness? When we think of things like social or for social emotional awareness, we should be thinking of things along the lines of, can our children sit during a circle time? And for your kindergartners, typically their circle time is going to be, or their morning circle time will normally be between 20 to 40 minutes, depending on what they're doing throughout that day. During that time, there should be lots of getting up and there should be lots of singing and lots of music. But overall, are students socially and emotionally ready? Are they able to regulate their emotions as they're moving throughout their day? So when we're looking at quality preschool, we should also be asking ourselves, what are the lasting benefits? Is this something that's just going, is this something that I'm just doing so that I can go to work? Or is this something that's actually going to have a benefit to my child? One thing that I will let you guys know is that we can look at the reading level of a third grader and we can know kind of how what the trajectory of that child's literacy and what their projections for graduation will be based off of the third grade reading levels. We also can look at the 18-month-old's vocabulary and the words that they recognize and know what those reading levels are going to be in third grade. So we understand that if we're doing our jobs properly in early preschool and early education, then we are setting them up on a track for higher graduation rates. We are looking at about a 25% reduction in college or high school dropouts for students who have quality preschool education. We also understand that a quality preschool education provides more opportunities for higher education, which leads to opportunities for home ownership and higher wage paying jobs. So it's very important overall that you are choosing a preschool program that is going to benefit your child in the long run by ensuring kindergarten readiness, social emotional development, and that there is a balance of both. So looking at a quality preschool from the family's perspective, when you as a parent have a preschool program that you are able to go to every day, you know consistently that they are going to be open, that they are consistently going to have staff that are available to you. This is providing you with the ability to actually get out and work and do the things that are important to your family. Specifically for women, in 2021, 15% of women with kids were not working because of childcare, compared to 2% of men. So we understand that a quality preschool program disproportionately affects women over men. We also understand that in 2020, half of all parents who had not returned to work cited childcare as the primary reason. So it's very difficult, and we recognize this in the industry. And as a parent myself, I recognize that there is a lot of stress around what am I going to do for my child to get them to where they need to be on a day-to-day basis so that I can go to work, so that I am comfortable enough to be and be in the environments that I need to be in and to have my mind set and my mind right so that I can get the work that I need to be get done and know that my child is in a safe environment. One of the benefits for a family of having a proper childcare system is also support in child rearing and resources. We often say that, you know, having a child, you don't get a playbook, you don't get a owner's manual on your child. But when you have a proper village, when you have a support system that is really geared around you, this is where you find that you can activate your village to ensure that if you have questions about how do I handle this behavior, or is my child meeting the developmental milestones that he or she is supposed to be meeting, who do I go to? Some of the supports that we have found within our system are things like the Infant Toddler Network. This is an organization that you can go to if you're concerned that your child is not meeting their proper milestones. You can go to them and request evaluations, request assessments so that you can get to the resources that are necessary. So lastly, we want to talk about the benefits of quality preschool around community. One of the things that we know is that if our economy is not thriving, or when our economy is thriving, it is because we have a childcare program in strong ecosystem. As an economy, or as having a quality preschool within our economy, keeps local businesses thriving. It ensures that we are all able to go to work. It ensures that the employers are able to have quality workers. Those quality workers have their mind where it's supposed to be because they trust the programs that they've entrusted their children to. During COVID, our governor, as he was shutting down various institutions, he got up and he asked childcare providers specifically to ensure that they stayed open. And he said that we were essential workers and essential to the continuation of the economy, because if the childcare system closed, then there would be no workers, there would be no grocery workers, there would be no first responders, key workers who are vital to the operation of our programming or to our society here would not be possible were it not for the childcare provider. Healthy community ecosystems, when more childcare options are available, our labor force and participation increases. We also know that 19% of parents who stopped working entirely in the same quarter in which they experienced a disruption to their childcare arrangements. And that was compared only to 9% who did not experience a disruption. So people are leaving their jobs. People are leaving their ways of bringing food to their table when they do not have proper childcare. So very, very important to our economy and to our local businesses that we have proper childcare. So we've talked about the benefits of a quality preschool program. And I hear it said over and over, we have to have quality preschool. We have to have quality preschool. But the key piece of this is that we need to recognize what does it mean to be a quality provider? What does it mean to be a provider that is accessible, a provider that is culturally competent and responsive, a provider that is ensuring that your child is not just social emotionally ready, but also academically ready for kindergarten, creating a holistic student environment for kindergarten readiness? So let's talk about that just a little bit. So when we look at culturally competent and responsive childcare systems, first off, we want to really dive into, and one of the things that we do when we do, childcare walkthroughs, sometimes we'll go and we'll set up a meeting with a provider. And we don't always think about all of the things that we need to ask that provider, things that we need to look around into the childcare setting to ensure that we're choosing the right environment for our student. Not every childcare center is going to be the right fit for your child, and vice versa. So it's really important that you know what your family values are and you know what's important to your family and ensure that the childcare center that you are looking into is meeting that need. So first and foremost, you want to ask your provider, how do you learn about your students? We should never enter into a childcare setting where we believe that we are the only educators in the room. We should be learning continuously, not just from our families, but also from the students that we receive. We need to learn more about how the family operates. What are the values of the family? What is the parenting style that these children are involved in? And then make sure that we are implementing that into our programs. We need to make learning fun and culturally relevant. Sometimes we in childcare, we can get so wrapped up in making sure that we are checking the boxes on all of the different milestones and things that we want that we need to accomplish to make sure that these kiddos are kindergarten ready, that we forget to have fun. So when you walk into a childcare center, you're looking to see like what art is available. You know, what are their activities? What are they doing? What type of family engagement activities are they doing? How are you keeping learning and engaging fun and also being culturally relevant? We don't want to embark in a childcare setting or journey that they are only talking about culture during, you know, the end of the year where we talk about celebrations. We should be talking about culture and the beauty that culture plays in our day-to-day environment on a daily basis. And so you're really looking at the full environment to see how are they keeping learning fun and how are they being culturally relevant. You want to look to see if your childcare center is depicting a range of cultures and not just looking stereotypically at cultures. So you may walk into a center that has photos of people, say, from Western Africa or photos from people in the Middle East, and they're the very stereotypical photos. And that's okay. That's okay to have those in your center. But are there other areas that you are depicting culture? Are you posting art from those various countries? Are you reading books? Are the books reflective of the various cultures that your center is representing? Is the center representative of the students that it's serving? Oftentimes, we will just throw up photos around our centers that, you know, honestly, you can print off Google or you can purchase a stack of cultural photos. Look to see, are there photos from the families that are presented around your center? Because that is a true depiction of the cultures that are represented in the various centers. When you're looking at guest speakers and you're looking at different activities that they may have within their center, you want to ask the individual that is doing the walkthrough, are you asking people of color? Are you asking various cultures to be a part of this activity? Are you bringing in various insights? Are we looking just through one lens? If we are talking, if we're having community resource day, are we only bringing in, you know, male police officers and male firefighters? Is there diversity in the individuals that you are bringing and putting before my children to represent the excellence of our community? Very, very important. Another important factor in finding a culturally competent and responsive center is, are you individualizing the learning throughout the classroom? Our childcare philosophy or a curriculum philosophy, is really founded or based on Howard Gardner's multiple intelligence theory. And that theory asks the question, not are you smart, but how are you smart? This theory really dives into the way that a child learns first and foremost, understanding that that is the way that we are going to introduce any new curriculum. And then we're going to take that and make sure that the areas that that child may be weak in, we're going to use those that knowledge base and build them up throughout the unit. So asking, what are the ways that you're going to individualize the curriculum that you're delivering? Now, it doesn't have to be that center uses Howard Gardner's multiple intelligence theory, but they should have a very clear and distinct way that they are individualizing care throughout their classroom, throughout their daily interactions. Another way that we look at culturally competent and responsive care is respect. What is your adult interaction like? How do you communicate with not just your staff, but with your families? One of the things that I talk a lot about is the fact that we in early childhood education, in K-12 education, and in the medical field, we really have to get our minds wrapped around the fact that we are here to support the families. The family is the primary, is the cornerstone teacher. The family is the one that is going to take whatever it is that we teach and either say, this is not what we do in this house, or they're going to re-solidify everything that we are teaching by holding true to those things. So it makes sense that we find out first and foremost what the culture and the family dynamic is, what is the family makeup, what are the values that this family holds dear, and then we implement that into our curriculum, and that we are working side by side with respect and honor to that family and their teaching styles to ensure that our students have the best possible outcomes. When we think about cultural competence, a lot of the times we all in education will say, oh, absolutely, you know, we respect the family, we respect their ways. But do we really look at the full cultural makeup of a family? And do we honor that? A lot of the times we are looking or we are working with families that do not come from Western civilization, and their way of doing things, their way of parenting, of nurturing, of disciplining can look very, very different when it comes to guidance and discipline specifically. And so one of the things that we talk about is, how do you work with a family that spanks versus a family that doesn't spank? Right? Have we faced our biases? Because in the Western world, we take a very strong stance, typically publicly, we take a very strong stance around spanking and what we believe to be right. Keeping in mind that a vast majority of societies outside of the Western civilization, they still spank, they still believe in it. And so when you come into contact with a family such as that, what is your response? How do you work with that family to ensure that the guidance and discipline that we are offering at our center is still able to be recognized as safe and equitable for the students that are coming in? What is the community responsibility towards guidance and discipline? And how does the family see that? It's very important when you, as a parent are going into a childcare center that you are very clear about the way that you guide and discipline your students. Some of us are parents who do gentle parenting. Some of us are parents who don't do quite so gentle parenting, and it's okay, right? As a childcare provider, we're all mandated reporters, but we are reporting issues of suspected abuse or things along that nature. It is okay to come into a space and say, this is the way that I parent, and these are the things that I believe need to be honored and respected for my family, and then working with the organization to ensure that those things are being met and those things are being respected in a healthy way. We also want to take a look at food preferences. And this is also one that I find in early childhood education that sometimes we really struggle with. I use the example of some of our West African families or Middle Eastern families who sit on the floor for meals. And in childcare and early childhood education, a lot of times we like kids to sit in their seats because it's nice and clean and everybody has bellies to the table, and that works really well in a typical environment. But being mindful that there is no harm, no foul if you set up a sanitary space on your floor so that a child who is more comfortable eating on the floor or sitting on the floor and enjoying a meal, that should be allowed. There should also be allowances made for children who would like to join in and experience that cultural event. Because we want to ensure that we are expanding on our child's worldview. We're expanding on their ability to see things through a different perspective. And then allergies versus preferences. This is one that we don't always consider, but we definitely should. You know, a family who is vegan or vegetarian by choice versus a family who's child cannot have peanut allergies. Are we facing that bias? Are we ensuring that we're not saying things that, lend more towards our way of thinking when it comes to feeding our students? And again, being mindful of the differences and the beautiful variances that each perspective has. And so these are areas that we can all take a closer look at when we're selecting our childcare facility. So you've gotten through all of that. You're at your walkthrough for your child care center, and they've passed kind of the cultural relevancy test. And so as far as curriculum, as far as environment setup and biases. So then you start asking about the diversity in staff. In the Pacific Northwest, in Spokane specifically, I believe we're about 87% white in Spokane. And for Black Americans, there's about 2.7% of us here. And so this is always a great question because it's not that you're going to find a person of color in every single center, but you want to know if the people that you are entrusting your child to see the value in being intentional about recruiting people of color and ensuring that their worldview is opened as far as humanly possible from Spokane, Washington. So asking the center provider, what is your ethnic staff makeup? Does your staff reflect the students that you serve? If you have students that are from an Indigenous background or from an Asian American background or a Black American Black background, are you making valiant effort to find individuals that cover and represent the students that you're serving? Why is that so important? It is important because if we do not see ourselves doing great things, then we're less likely to do great things or believe that we can acquire or aspire towards those great things. So one of the things that I like to talk about is how do we become intentional in serving our students? So here in Spokane, there's a couple of different organizations, culturally based resource community organizations, such as the Carl Maxey Center. The Carl Maxey Center is a Black American community center that a childcare provider could go to and say, hey, here's my card, here's my information. If you find anybody that is looking for a job, from this community, please send them my way. I would love to interview them. Ahana here is a multi-ethnic community and business development center, as is Latinos in Spokane, a wonderful Hispanic American program that provides resources, or the Refugee and Immigrant Connections. These are all amazing resources that if your childcare center is being intentional about their hiring, it's no longer enough to say, well, no one applied, right? Oh, that's fine. No one applied. But what did you as a provider do to ensure quality in your program? Do you see this as something that you need to purposefully go out and acquire? And so these are just a few of the ways that you can do that. So we talked a little bit about kindergarten readiness a little bit earlier in our conversation. We talked about knowing your district's requirements. And again, in the resource document that we provided, there is a link for that. We also want to know each school should have a section of guidelines or goals that each classroom is aspiring towards. At RAZE Development Inc., each one of our classrooms builds off of the other. And so for all of the domains that we're teaching, there are set of guidelines or milestones that each child that we're looking to make sure that each child is receiving. We want to make sure things like your child is beginning to initiate sharing of materials. If they're in the infant room, we want to make sure that they are turning their heads when they're hearing various sounds. We want to work with them on object permanence. And so even though we're playing peekaboo, right, that's actually curriculum. We're working on object permanence. When my face is behind my hands, my face is still there. It's still available. Just because you can't see me doesn't mean I'm not available. So these are things that we're really working on with the students, and it builds and builds and builds until you get to the pre-K program, and you are with RAZE. We are working on kindergarten first quarter work within our pre-kindergarten program, because again, being culturally responsive and understanding, we know that a lot of the children that are going to come through our doors are children who are going to face various challenges, and we want to make sure that we are ensuring that they're kindergarten ready, but that they stay ready. And as they work through some of those new social emotional challenges in a more public setting, that they're not losing out on some of the work that we've worked so hard for. One of the things that's really important is how your center communicate your child's success to you. If I stand up at the graduation podium on our pre-kindergarten graduation day and I say, all of these kids are kindergarten ready, but you've never received an assessment from me, you've never received any type of notification from me or indication that your child has met any milestones, that's a problem. You should be receiving quarterly assessments. You should have conversations with your students. You should have communication, continuous communication, either through social media, through a childcare center app, or even your parent-teacher conferences. You should have some type of communication around your child's success. And anyone who is doing a walkthrough should be able to tell you the many different ways that they are giving that information to parents. Within the RAZE program, we have a app that parents are able to log into and see the activities that their children are doing throughout the day. But we also have quarterly parent-teacher conferences, and that can be on the phone, that can be on a Zoom call or in person, whatever is most convenient for the parent, just as long as we have time to sit down and discuss what is happening with your child in the classroom and where we see their end goal and them attaining that end goal. So we talked a little bit about curriculum as well. To dive a little bit deeper again, what is the curriculum philosophy of the center that you're putting your student into? Every childcare center should have a curriculum philosophy, should have a set principle around the curriculum that they're going to be offering and providing, and who and when it will be implemented and how will it be implemented. They should have a clear goal on the individualized learning and what that looks like. You should be able to see the individualized learning. You should know what your child's learning style is. These are all ways that we ensure that no child is falling behind, no child is left being put into a box of learning and expected to move forward without knowing what they need. So one thing that I have found as a parent is that I often did not know what my rights were as a parent. I didn't know which questions to ask. I didn't know what information I was privy to. And so we've taken some time to put or to find a parent's bill of rights. And this is also available in the resource guide that I sent out or that will be posted in the chat group. But again, you have a right to know what your child is doing. You have a right to clear and effective communication from the provider that you choose. You have a right to family activities. You should be continuously engaged in your child's education. You know, kindergarten readiness is not just for the child. Kindergarten readiness is also for the parent. As a parent, you should be kindergarten ready, because as you're moving from a classroom typically of 10 to 20 with one to two teachers after 10, one to 10 ratio, to a classroom of up to one to 25, right? So if you have your child, you put your child in a classroom of 18 to 20 students with one teacher, how do you ensure that your child does not get left behind? If your child is not the brightest child in the classroom, or if your child is not the child that is distributing behaviors, your child will be in just kind of that very typical, that typical middle ground, the likelihood that the information will be individualized, the likelihood that your child is going to have time set aside specifically for him becomes very low. And so we want to make sure that our parents are equipped with the questions. We want to make sure that our parents are used to attending parent-teacher conferences. And so your question to your provider should be, how do you ensure parent kindergarten readiness? How do you ensure that I am ready to advocate and I know when to advocate for my child in a public school or even a private school setting? So there are some parenting supports here in Spokane. We have Northwest Autism. This is an organization that works with students that are on the spectrum of autism. We have Frontier Behavioral, which is a mental health behavioral support system for that has a pediatric ward all the way through adulthood. And then we also have the Carl Maxey Center. And at the Carl Maxey Center, we have parenting classes, we have doula courses or doula courses and doula story times. And so another really great resource to take advantage of. And finally, find a cultural parenting class. Ask your provider if they know of any cultural, regardless of your cultural background, do you know of any cultural parenting classes that really speak to my lineage, that speak to the way that we do things within my family? Nothing in life is cookie cutter, at least it shouldn't be, because we're all very different humans. And least of all, parenting should be cookie cutter. We are not all going to be gentle parents. Some of us may be gentle parents and some may not. And so really making sure that we understand our parenting style, just like there's a learning style, there's also a parenting style. And there are parenting styles that are very unique to the various cultures. And so making sure that you understand that and you can pick and choose which part of that parenting style you want to change or you want to get further behind. But finding a cultural parenting class would be great. Here are just a few lists of various community resources throughout Spokane. And these are all ones that your childcare provider should be aware of. You know, there's everything from Joya, which is a therapy for families and children 0 to 3 with developmental delays or even disabilities. I have seen amazing, fabulous work come through Joya. Stepping Stones, they provide pediatric occupational physical and speech therapy to students, and they will send their therapist into a childcare center. So if you are already partaking in some of these resources, another thing to ask your provider is this something that we are able to take advantage of within the childcare setting? We should not need everything to be so siloed that we are not able to come together as a community and provide these supports. And so one of the things that I really love about Stepping Stones is that oftentimes I will see their therapist throughout our center, really engaging with the students in their environment. There are also some behavioral supports here in Spokane. I mentioned Frontier Behavioral, but there's also a special needs rate pay. So this is for students who are having extreme behaviors in their classroom, and it can be due to a developmental delay, it could be due to trauma. And so you can apply through DCYF. If you've already qualified for DCYF, you can apply to DCYF to receive benefits. And it could be anything from, you know, they are providing half day benefits all the way up to full day benefits. And they provide that funding to the provider. And then the provider is able to go out and hire in a specialist to provide one-on-one supports for the student that is in need. Why MADBRO is an organization that actually works primarily out of the high schools, teaching young men how to be young men in a society such as ours. And so teaching them things about, you know, a value system, teaching them things about standing in their masculinity in a healthy and productive way, and really creating leaders and mentors in our high school programs. This is one that I personally have had my son be a part of at his local high school, and I've seen the benefits of it. As far as cultural hubs, we all need a place to go. You know, there's that song, I Wanna Go Where Everybody Knows My Name. This is a perfect example of that. We have many cultural-based organizations here in Spokane. The Carl Maxey Center, again, is Spokane's African-American or Black American community hub. They have Spades Nights there, which is a game. I think it's a cultural game that we play. It's amazing. But there's also, you know, we have a Zumba class there and all of these great things that happen. There's art exhibits from within our community. Latinas in Spokane is another great cultural hub that provides cultural-based activities as well as supports within the community. As are the others that I've listed here, all kind of providing similar opportunities for just cultural gathering and supports. There are some legal services that are available and that your childcare provider should be aware of. A lot of the times, you know, we have families that are going through separation and that are needing some supports around legal services. Here in Spokane, we have quite a few, the Northwest Justice Project, the Spokane Volunteers and Lawyers Program. Obviously, the YWCA provides legal support for survivors of domestic violence or intimate partner violence, and several others that we have, but here's just a few. There's some food support services. No one should go hungry. We have lots of food within the community. And so there are a few places, one that is not on here, that provides both doula services and a food program is the Shades of Motherhood Network. Our West Central, some of our food pantries, the Martin Luther King Food Bank. These are all places that families can go to receive food or more food supports. And then we also have developmental screening supports. These are so incredibly important. I don't know about you, but I don't have all of the developmental milestones that my toddler should have met. But to know that there is a place that I can go and take my child and have them screened to make sure that if there are early intervention processes that need to be enacted, that I'm able to take advantage of those are vital. And so there's a couple of opportunities for that here. Lastly, when we're looking at affordable and accessible childcare, that really is the key. There can be the most quality childcare programs around, but if you don't have access to them, then it's not an equitable ecosystem. So there's the Working Connections Childcare. This is a program that a statewide program that subsidizes childcare. It allows families to enter the workforce. You are given childcare approval for a year. Whether you lose your job or you change shifts, you have typically full-time childcare for an entire year. If you apply originally and you've applied and you've only been given part-time care, that's okay. You can then go, and once you bump up to full-time, if you choose to do so, then you'll be given that full-time care within the year. You can also be going to school part-time and working part-time and receive full-time care through Working Connections. Currently, the eligibility threshold for that is about 65% of the median income level. We are expecting that to increase to 80% of the median income level by 2025. Recently, there were a couple of bills that passed within the childcare industry just at this most recent legislative session. Bill HB 1199. Basically, this bill allows individuals to create childcare facilities and childcare centers within, you know, housing developments, within apartment complexes, without the governing organization telling them that they cannot have it, as long as they are adhering to the Washington administrative codes. We are now allowed to expand our childcare reach and our childcare offerings in apartment complexes, again, or within even like an HOA situation where you might be in a neighborhood that has historically said that childcare centers, in-home childcare centers, can't be a part. They have now passed a law in Washington that says that that is illegal, that you can have a childcare center in any common community interest. Bill SB 5225 increases access to Working Connections and the childcare program. This is one that I am particularly excited about. As a childcare provider, I have had several times over the course of my 15 years in this industry where my employees as childcare providers have had to leave the industry or had to stop working because they could no longer afford childcare. And I want that to sink in. Childcare providers were getting to a point where they were no longer able to afford childcare, and so they had to quit their jobs. And there was a myriad of reasons that this was happening. Recently, there was a bill that passed that says that as long as a childcare provider is making 80% or less of the median income, they qualify for childcare regardless of any additional issues that may have made them ineligible. So this could be that, dad and mom were living together and dad's income was putting the family just over the threshold. And so the family no longer were eligible for Working Connections. Regardless of all of that, as long as the family income is under 80%, which has raised, that 20%. And then there are also local resources that are providing affordable and accessible childcare. So another portion of the work that I do here in our community is that I'm a community advocate. Recently, through my team's advocacy work at the Spokane Alliance, we were able to secure $6.5 million for childcare within the community. And so what that allowed us to do is provide funding for middle-income families who are returning to work to receive stipends for childcare. It's allowing us to provide childcare providers with stipends for, bonuses for being in the childcare industry. It's allowing us to provide sign-on bonuses to really try to stabilize and retain the workers that we have. And so these are all areas that we are working right now within Washington State and locally here in Spokane to ensure that all families have equitable and accessible childcare. And then the housing and community supports at the Carl Maxey Center is providing, has been providing rental and utility services, our SNAP program, Community Minded, all of these offerings available to our families to try to help ensure that they are receiving the care that they so richly deserve as they are trying to just work and make sure that their students are safe and happy. That really is the end of what I wanted to say to you all today. I want to reiterate the importance of creating your village. I don't want to say that I want to empower parents because that implies that the power was somehow not with you. As a parent of a child, you are the most important teacher. You are the cornerstone of everything that your child will eventually become. You set the foundation, and we are here to support you in every way that matters. Our programs should be reflective of the families that are coming to us. And if they are not, then we should be making intentional and very purposeful processes and programs to ensure that we are bringing that cultural piece in, whether it's the various ethnicities or just in whatever way that your family presents, we should be able to represent that. And so I thank you for your time. I'm happy to answer any questions that you might have at this time. And I just very much appreciate all the work that you are doing to raise wonderful, wonderful children. And I hope that you find your quality program. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Kerra. That was a lot of amazing information that you shared. And I was frantically putting in all of the URLs so I could have access to those resources as well and share them out. So we do have a question and they asked, are there any subsidies that are for parents with one parent not working or going to school?
One parent, so two parents in the home, but one parent's not working or going to school and just one parent is.
I think so.
Okay. So here in Spokane, the Spokane Workforce Council, as well as Community Minded Enterprises, that $6.5 million that I referred to came from ARPA funding, the American Rescue Plan dollars that came as a result of COVID. A part of those funds are for families, regardless of your family situation, are for families that are trying to get back into the workforce. So if you have one member of the family who is not working, but the other one is trying to get back in, they should be able to apply for some of those finances that are available for the families. I believe that it's like a 3-month stipend and up to, I believe it's 75%. I don't have the fullness of that, but the link is in that that resource guide that we provided so that you can access that. And I know that the application for those grants are available currently through the Spokane Workforce Council.
Fantastic. I think the fact that there aren't other questions means that you covered the topic really, really well. That being said, like I said, there will be a follow-up email and I will include Kara's contact information. We do have somebody that said, thank you for emphasizing the importance around this subject. I believe it is very important for parents to be involved and understand the system of childcare.
Absolutely. Thank you all.
All right. Thank you so much, Kara. And like I mentioned, we will be following up shortly with a resource email.
Lovely. Bye, everyone.
Bye, everyone.